Now we'll take questions from the audience.
This is Piyali Sen from Tata Consultancy Services. My question is for Gift. Mr. Gulabchand, explain the governance model of Lavasa City, where he mentioned it will be having a central administrative body which will be responsible for the municipal governance of the city. I would like to know that in Gift, what is the municipal governance model that you would be following? Would the state government or would the government be maintaining the city? Or would you be similarly having a central administrative body within the premises of Gift?
Something similar is being experimented. There's a special study group for policies. As I explained in the presentation, there's a separate DCR rule that is being formed in terms of its implementation process. And there's a separate area development authority, which is not under a urban development authority. A separate development authority has been designated. We are trying to progress in the study, and it's still under finalization. But something similar has been thought of.
My Pratap Padode from Construction World. My question is for Mr. Gulabchand. Mr. Gulabchand, Lavasa is a hill station, as you said, and therefore, it has to, the people living in that city have to depend on tourism. So how have you accounted for the kind of capacity you need? Because being close to cities like Mumbai and Pune is going to have larger traffic during the weekends. And like it was in the case of Lonavala and Khandala earlier. So what kind of planning has gone on to this, and how do you plan it to be sustainable?
Hill station, when the British built it, was in the old sleepy way with the money spent by the people of India. It took over whatever time. It can't be done that way. It has to be an economic entity that is vibrant and has generated its own economy. It's a place to live, work, learn and play, and therefore it has three basic economic drivers. One is, of course, tourism, hospitality, leisure, which is not just weekend, but during the week through convention centers. Leisure, like NASA Space World and MGM Bollywood and Hollywood theme parks and etc., which would have also a during the week tourism. But in addition to that, the main draw is going to be that it will be a big center for education. A large number of schools and colleges are expected to be set up there. As per the commitments already made by schools and colleges to set up there, 10,000 students will be studying in Lavasa by 2012. We expect that this figure will go to 50,000 by 2015. In addition to that, there are businesses that we're expected to settle in Lavasa, businesses that are research centers, both global research centers of multinational companies, as well as research centers of Indian companies, as well as business training centers. In addition to that, a film studio is being planned there. And this film studio is going to be set up there. So there is going to be a center of performing arts, a center, an art gallery, a school of art, school of design, school of architecture, school of urban design, school of urban planning. So when you look at the totality of it, it is going to have businesses of all kinds. They all have to be soft, because it is no polluting or no basic industry, except for non-polluting, is allowed there. There are also a lot of local handicraft industry like bamboo, etc., that has already begun there. So when you look at the total work, like a hotel school, Lausanne School of L'Ecole Hotelière, Lausanne, has already started its operation in Lavasa. So you have a large number of colleges and schools, both foreign and Indian, that are looking at it as executive development center, schools and colleges coming up, which is a mainstay. When you talk of 50,000 students, you're talking about 10,000 professors, teachers, and administrative staff. When you look at research centers, even if there are five big research centers, you're talking of about somewhere in the vicinity of about 3,000 to 4,000 scientists. So when you look at this composition, it is going to be primarily on innovation and rejuvenation of different kinds. So it's a city with an economy of its own. Of course, sustained by the broader economy of the Bombay-Pune region. Besides, the new airport of Pune is exactly about 1 hour from Lavasa. actually in some ways closer to Lavasa than it is to Pune International Airport.
My name is Shankarabhai. The question is to Mr. Gulabjan. Sir, you have propounded certain theory in your presentation. Lavasa having been a successful experiment with you, how are you proposing to move forward on the concept which you propounded?
I would yet not rush to say Lavasa is a successful experiment. It is an experiment, but it's based on a number of rationalities and a need of the migration that I talked about. So we expect that it will get populated. If you ask me what is the mission of people, those inside Lavasa, it is to populate Lavasa. And I have a 365-day economy. Once this concept of public-private partnerships is established at both the level of planning, at the level of policing, of providing security to the place, which again is not a gated community, and lastly, on the municipal governance of the place, this model can be replicated. And once replicated, it is applicable to new cities, to neighborhoods of existing cities, and it may be possible that to make some very mega cities governable, we'll have to break them into smaller municipalities.
Mr. Ajit Gulabjanji. Yeah, I'm Smita Shah from Sadbhavna Sangh. It's a Gandhian-based social organization. Sir, you spoke very well about the private and public partnership. Of course, it's a very good, when you are setting up a new city, new setup, you can do everything as per your plan. But something like in Bombay, what do you think of the idea of Nagar Raj Bill or any other such democratic instrument which we try to which tries to bring about decentralization at a local level in a city?
At the core of any kind of working cities of the future in India or anywhere in the world, as is necessary that the governing power be devolved to the cities and towns. This is an absolute essential, without which it is very difficult to think of a city. And you can have a city governance. There are places in United States like St. Louis that has 90 municipalities. So you can have a broader city government with several municipalities taking on small areas. And for in a city like Bombay, even a small area or a cluster in terms of density can be bigger than the country Maldives or Bahrain. So we've got to look at these models, and we've got to look at new models because we have to find a way to govern our country effectively. With such a large youthful population, it's going to be very difficult to contain them if we don't provide them with good governance.
Good afternoon, sir. Sorry. Shantanu Khankar, LBH College of Architecture, Department of Urban Design. So my question is actually directed all the three speakers, sorry. The way our cities are expanding today into the rural hinterlands, often at the expense of agricultural lands. And since we are going to double or triple our urban population in the next 50 or 100 years, do you foresee a future in which we might face a crisis in feeding that urban population? And taking that in mind, do you consider that urban agriculture is something that we should consider when designing these new cities? Secondly, the villages that are existing on these outskirts and which will be integrated into the urban sprawl. Considering the condition of the urban villages in Mumbai, the Gautam areas, what kind of a future do you foresee for these villages, and what kind of guidelines or interventions should we make to kind of control or guide that development? Thank you.
First, it must be remembered that even if this large population moves to towns and cities, they would not take up more than 2% of the total agricultural space. So there's no real competition between urban area, because urban area, it grows vertical, it is dense, and as far as that is concerned. Second is, there is going to be agricultural productivity increase. Already there is an agricultural productivity increase, which has rendered number of people jobless in the rural areas. This is why they are migrating, and they will increasingly migrate. new kinds of food. Look at what hybrid did to India. India changed, we could feed ourselves, and it changed the agricultural productivity. Reconsolidation of land holdings in India plus irrigation is going to change again the next level of agricultural productivity. The next important thing that you got to realize is that you got to form a clean process by which these villages are assimilated into the bigger city, by a due process. We don't have it. We try to retain them like in Bangalore as pockets of villages, and therefore you have a municipal governance that is in certain parts of Bangalore. Right in the middle you will have a village governance, so a lot of illegal structures are coming out. I think like anywhere else in the world, we must have a process by which these villages then get assimilated into what is known as the city area. We have done that process in Delhi, where you find that though the union territory of Delhi is small, place from regional other states like Haryana, UP that have become part are called the national capital region and included in it. So there are various ways of doing this, but we must lay down the procedures. And it's possible to do that. Even in Bombay, you can split up the Bombay Municipal Corporation. It is possible to do that.
I just want to add to that. In fact, I was expecting this kind of question from an architectural fraternity here. What will happen to urban villages? In fact, he also would share this concern. Especially if you can refer to, I made a fleeting mention of this scheme called urban development. It's between urban and rural. There's something, an initiative which I personally, have interest in. It is providing social, what happens in routine course, even there's a separate governance or there's a centralized governance for both the city and the urban villages per se. What happens is in physical planning, when we plan the cities or when we plan extensions, this fact of typical Lal Dora development and ignorance of development within is ignored. So taking care of the social amenities that are needed, providing space for the village to grow has to be inbuilt in the planning process, which is what this urban policies talk about. You may be interested in to look into it. And there are various researches also has been done by SEPT University on urban development. It'll be very interesting for you to see.
That village can grow into another local municipality, and the sarpanch can become the small mayor of that little municipality.
Add about the loss of agricultural land. I think that's a really major problem. And with the more infrastructure development, we'll see more people moving out to suburbs. Right now, the reason they are not, because of the lack of infrastructure. And the government should form a policy on preserving important agricultural land, a productive agricultural land. And I think that should be, actually government should act right now so that we can take care of it rather than wait until, we get there. So I'm really concerned because I know I've seen that happen in so many other countries, US, including US.
A question for Mr. Gulabchand. You're talking about rental housing. Now, you also talked about the kind of immigrants that you expected. But besides the researchers and the students, there'll be a huge percentage of construction workers and service, class and all that. So what is the kind of income profile that you expect? And for the lowest income people, is there any provision in your plan? What kind of housing would you provide for them?
There are about 10,000 homes being provided, basically, which are going to be bought from 10 lakh rupee studio apartments to 2 crore rupee villas. And there is going to be social housing. Almost 40,000 units of social housing are provided on rental, going up from 500 rupees to 3,000 rupees for those who migrate to that place in order to work there. It will also have construction sites, which will provide its own construction camps. So I think there is sufficient housing for social that is provided, without which it is not possible to build that city.
My name is Chabi Mishra. I'm a landscape architect. I worked for a number of years in the US, and I've recently started working as a landscape architect with Eskedas Associated Architects. And my question is to Mr. Naman. As you know, in the West, community participation is a big part of the decision-making process in any design project. And I was just curious in this project in Bangalore, how much of that has been taken into consideration, or was it even a part of it at all, or do you even want to make an attempt in doing so?
Community participation in India, I don't know what. Communities have in India right now have very little say in private developments. It's not that they have now actually in Bangalore, they have started forming this organization, and they are becoming more active about it. But in this project, no, there wasn't any effort made to involve the community.
I'm Vale from the MCGM. My question is to Mr. Gulabchand. The local body which you conceptualize for Lavasa, what legal entity will it have? How will you hold it accountable? And how will you vest it with powers for regulation and prosecution?
At this present moment, this whole idea is under conceptual. But as per the Indian constitution, even so far, there is a provision for local municipalities to be created. So the whole area will at one stage get declared as one. The question is as to whether how we can create a new kind of municipal corporation that would be able to deliver the quality of service that the citizens of Lavasa will be used to while it still is private and will continue to deliver afterwards. So we will have to create some new model, because it is not so easy for a small village to suddenly grow in 5-10 years to be a city unless we create a new model out of it. But fundamentally, the components of a certain citizen's freedom to decide what they would like to do versus the quality of service that should be assured, so that there is no need to form cooperative societies to get water to the building, will also have to be created.
Next question is to Mr. Umesh. What FSI, the township which you spoke about, what FSI do you have for the township? Because we see that about 70% of the area is open and only 30% area is to be constructed. And secondly, you spoke about the nala, cleaning the nala, filtering the water, or having a filtration sort of a plant for the nala or something. But that nala does not originate in that township. Must be coming from behind, must be carrying all the muck and passing through that township. So probably you'll not be able to control all that muck.
Yeah, the FSI right now, the approved FSI is 3.65 over this land, because it's been notified as a different area, gift area. So it's a different FSI than the rest of the land. Hence, there's a possibility of keeping a large area open. And again, speaking of nalas, there are three. In fact, it's a ravinous ecology there also. It will be very, very interesting for him to study. We are keeping all of those intact because of this kind of a provision.
About the Bangalore project, the first thing we did was looked at the catchment area for the nala. And we noticed that there was only a very small portion of that nala water is coming from other sites. So we feel very confident about this approach, that we will be able to keep the water clean in that nala. So we are very fortunate in this case that, yeah, most of the catchment area is within our site.
Thank you.